Hello, everyone. This is Etan Thomas. Thank you for being with us today as we celebrate Black History Month. And while we celebrate the stories, experiences, and brilliance of Black people throughout history, we are also in a moment of reckoning. Over the past 11 months, we've seen the impacts of a global pandemic that disproportionately impacts Black and Brown people, exposing the pre-existing systems of oppression that have been at work for generations. In the traumatic aftermath of the murders of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and too many others, NBA and WNBA players joined millions of Americans participating in peaceful demonstrations, calling for justice and making their voices heard in the ballot box. We're in a new year, but there's still so much work to be done. So today, we'll focus on the movement for racial justice with leading voices from the NBA and WNBA player community, an attempt to answer the question, where do we go from here? Let's start by meeting our guests. Today, I'm proud and honored to be joined by a 13-year NBA veteran from the Utah Jazz, Mike Conley Jr., Sydney Colson, a 6-year WNBA veteran and member of the WNBA Social Justice Council. And finally, please welcome an 8-year NBA veteran from the Sacramento Kings and member of the NBA Foundation Board of Directors, Harrison Barnes. Let me start with you, Harrison. Throughout your career, you've deeply embedded yourself in each community you've called home. Looking back at the last 12 months, from the pandemic to the protests to the election, how would you characterize this moment we are in as a society?
You know, I think that with, you know, everything that's been going on, you know, we're at an inflection point, you know, with the pandemic, eliminating a lot of distractions, it allowed people to have more awareness, to have different conversations, whether it's about racism, whether it's about white supremacy, whether it's about oppression, economic disparities, all of these conversations that a lot of people like to avoid are front and center. And I feel like with the election as well, there's a lot of energy, and finding ways to sustain that for change is where we're at right now.
I think that's a very good point. Sydney, let me ask you, after the murders of Breonna Taylor, you know, George Floyd, and countless others, you participated in peaceful protests in your hometown of Houston, Texas. Unfortunately, these tragedies are not new. But tell us about your personal journey as an advocate and why it's important for athletes and people with platforms to speak out for justice.
Well, I think what you mentioned is really key, that it's not anything that's new. But for some of us, in our lifetime, we hadn't seen protests take place like we did after George Floyd and Breonna Taylor, like nationwide and worldwide, you know, spanning so far. So for someone like me, that was the first protest in March that I've been a part of. And obviously George Floyd, you know, his family was from here, and he's from here. So marching at City Hall was a very emotional experience, and you really felt like you were, you know, a part of something that was hopefully gonna start to make some changes. But I think I speak for not only myself, but a lot of the women that were in the WNBA bubble. Like, that was our first go round with advocacy, with activism. And I think what I learned is that it's not something that you just can go into and you only speak about it from an emotion-filled position. Like, we had to really make sure that we were diving into these topics and being educated so that we could come at it from a stance of, like, knowing what we're talking about. And, you know, for Black people, I think a lot of times people think that we just know everything about racism and everything that's going on because we are the ones who are on the receiving end. But it's like, no, I realize I had a lot of, you know, educating to do myself.
Let me follow up with that, because, you know, one of the things I was always impressed with the WNBA is how you have all stuck together. Like, you do things as a group, as one unit. And, you know, I always thought that was so interesting, because a lot of the majority of players, they're from overseas, so they're not even from here. So they don't even know, you know, what's going on here. They just play here and then they leave. How did you go about educating your fellow international sisters and then go about them all joining you and standing together for Black Lives Matter?
Well, it was interesting because last season was a season where people opted out for a variety of reasons. Like, obviously COVID was going on, and so that changed some people's decision to opt in, whether they had illness-related problems that were going to make them more susceptible to COVID, mm-hmm. or what you're talking about, some people who were overseas, it just wasn't going to be a good idea for them to come over here and play because of what they could be, you know, predisposed to by traveling. And then obviously with the protests going on, I think it just wasn't super appealing for a lot of people. So it was interesting that we didn't have as many players in the bubble with us who were foreigners. But yeah, we have a league that's very unique in our makeup because of our diversity, but also because of the fact that there aren't a ton of us. There are 12 teams with a max of 12 players per team. So we have the ability to really get to know everyone, to be able to have moments where we can all jump on a call and be on the same page. And even if everybody doesn't necessarily agree, we can agree with the fact that we know we want to reach a certain goal. So it may not be someone's idea that we end up following, but they're willing to get on board because it's for the greater good.
Got you. Mike, you've been focused on giving back to the community for a long time now. You've won multiple NBA Care Community Assist Awards, and you've just been going above and beyond, you know, what it takes to make a difference. How has your approach to the work evolved over the years as the issues of racial injustice continue to become more and more urgent?
Well, you know, I think through my years of growing in each community, being in the, you know, in, you know, the front lines of a lot of the situations, and, you know, being able to understand what a lot of us are going through, it is, you know, it's been a growth for me. It's been an eye-opening experience, especially since I had kids. Like, as far as the racial justice and all that is concerned, it's made it, you know, even more personal, and it's made it even more of a goal of mine to see it through, that we find a way to make change. And, you know, whether that's in Memphis or Salt Lake City or wherever I'm at, I am constantly, you know, trying to figure out ways to, whether that is through education, legislation, you know, meeting with police chiefs, whatever the individual thing you can do is something I've been involved in ever since, you know, the past 5 or 6 years, where, you know, it seems like every other week there was another shooting, there was another, person, you know, getting murdered, or a family, you know, going through the same situations that have been going on for so long. So for me, it's just, you know, just continuing to try to do the work that I've been doing in the community, but focus it more, even more so to, you know, making change in you know, unjust system that's been going on for a very long time.
You know, for me personally, you know, my wife are blessed to have 3 children. And, you know, with children now, they have social media. They know about cases going on. You know, they come to me and ask me, "Hey, Dad, did you hear about this case that happened?" And when these things happen, there's the talk that happens in Black families. And a lot of people in mainstream America don't understand that talk that happens, where you have to, you know, go back and tell your kids, okay, you know, if you're stopped by the police, you have to do this. If you, you know, don't make sudden movements, don't do it. Is that something that happens in your household as well? Because it happens in my household literally every single time something like this happens.
Of course, you know, I think, you know, obviously I have a 4-year-old who's about to be 5 and a 2-year-old and a newborn. So the 5-year-old is the one that is obviously super curious and asks all the questions and wants to know why there's so many people on the streets. Why is there, you know, rioting? Why is there people marching? Like, why are people holding signs up? You know, just all the things that were going on over the past, you know, year or so, so openly on the news and internet, on our phones and TV, and even for us right down the street from where we live. I mean, it was, you know, people were marching up the streets where, you know, it was impossible for him to not, you know, to be shielded from it. And it's not something you really want to shield from. You want to tell them exactly, you know, why things are going on. But at the same time, it's, you know, as a father, as a parent, you're trying to do your best to shield them from the real world. But At some point, you know, you do have to have those talks, and you have to be able to sit down and be honest and candid and explain exactly, you know, what's got us here.
Definitely, definitely. Harrison, let's go back to the bubble. When you and your wife, Brittany, dedicated the first 8 Kings games to organizations honoring the victims of police brutality and gun violence, in all, you donated over $200,000 and, you know, highlighted their missions on social media. Tell us about that effort and the importance of using your platform to keep attention on those issues and those impacted families in particular.
We actually had a union call where, you know, a lot of people were just throwing out different ideas of how do we make the bubble more impactful with everything that was going on outside of the court and going on in our communities, and how do we bring that awareness and continue that conversation, you know, with the platform that we have. So, you know, obviously I chose to say their names on the back of my jersey, but I wanted to do something, as well as my wife wanted to do something that meant more than that. And, you know, we wanted to highlight organizations of families that have been affected, one, by police brutality, but two, that are doing the work to try to prevent that happening, you know, for somebody else's son, for somebody else's daughter, for somebody else's loved one. So that's what we tried to do. And, you know, all of those organizations, those are just 8, but there are so many more that are doing great work.
I mean, you helped out so many, you know, with the family members, you know, you helped out the Trayvon Martin Foundation, you know, Botham John Foundation, you have Tamir Rice Foundation. These are situations where everybody is aware of, but they don't know the efforts of the family members afterwards. You know, so a lot of times when a hashtag is trending and there's been a new murder by the police and everybody's focused on it, they don't understand that after the camera goes away, you know, the family is still left to deal with everything that is going on. So you highlighting their efforts and helping them in that way and using your platform is really important. What was the responses that they gave to you in particular?
Man, I mean, I think just getting on Zoom calls and just talking with them were some of the most impactful conversations really I've had just in my life. One, just hearing their pain, but two, hearing the purpose that they have and the drive that they have to make sure that how they're feeling, they don't want to see that with somebody else. And the bond that unfortunately all these families have is around this central issue of, you know, police violence in our communities. So, you know, really just having the chance to talk with them, let them know that they're supported, that I want to continue to bring awareness to what they're doing. And if there's anything myself, my teammates, or anybody else that wants to get tapped in can do to help, like, we're here.
I mean, that's really great work that you're doing. Sydney, let me go back to you. The 2020 WNBA season was really dedicated to social justice. And fans watching at home say that the commitment, you know, really came to life and how the players were using their platforms. You know, you answered a little bit before, but I want to ask you a little bit more. You know, as far as a collective unit, how important was it specifically to highlight Black women who are victims of police brutality? Because a lot of times, you know, that topic gets a little bit overshadowed. You know, there's not enough spoken about as far as how much Black women are really impacted by this issue of police brutality. So how important was saying her name in particular for the WNBA to really highlight?
Well, it was critical because we have a league that's made up of like 70 to 80% Black women. And so for us, when George Floyd, when Breonna Taylor, when those murders happen, obviously Breonna Taylor really, you know, hit home for us, and we had an opportunity to speak to Kimberly Crenshaw, who is one of our Social Justice Council advisors now, but she started the African American Policy Forum, and they're the ones who were behind the Say Her Name hashtag, which unbeknownst to me started in like 2014, and it was around when Mike Brown was killed. But at the same time, there was a woman, I believe it was Michelle Cousseau, who was murdered on a mental health call from police. They showed up and handled the situation mm-hmm. poorly and killed her. So this started that many years ago, and it really speaks to the fact that Say Her Name it was ironic because this hashtag was started to bring attention specifically to Black women who are killed from state violence and don't receive a lot of attention. And the fact that this was a hashtag that a lot of us Black women in the league didn't even know about, you know, speaks a lot to the fact that, you know, Black women being killed for a variety of reasons by police is not paid as much attention to. And so we wanted to dedicate our season to say her name, to Breonna Taylor, to all of these women. And it's really, I was thinking about while Harrison was speaking, the conversations that we had with these mothers, with these sisters, the support that they give these women. And I believe it's called like the sisterhood of sorrow or the sorority of sorrow that they all have. And it's like, it's not a sorority that you want to be a part of, but it's a bond, like he said, that these people share now because of this traumatic event that they've all experienced. And it was really eye-opening, really sad to hear about their stories, to hear the way that they're treated after their families were killed, the mishandling of evidence, the cover-ups, the everything, the trying to smear their family members' names when they're murdered. And so they're having to experience almost this second death by having to see their family member treated like that. So it was really sad, really eye-opening, but it really pushed us to want to bring more attention to it.
I think that's great. Mike Conley, I want to ask you a question. You're in Utah, and in Utah, there's the demographic, there's not a whole lot of us there. And I just interviewed Kyle Korver a few days ago, and he talked about the importance of white allies in particular, and why it was important for him to speak out on this topic, of him to point out the injustice and the racial inequity and, you know, police brutality and things of that nature. And we discussed how there's a certain element of mainstream America that will just hear it differently from him. And I wanted to ask you, what was the reactions of a lot of the white fans in Utah of their embrace of speaking out against police brutality and speaking up for Black Lives Matter? And how important is it for white allies in particular to speak up on those topics?
Well, yeah, you know, I've had the opportunity to speak to a lot of people who are from Utah, and all, everybody there, whether it's via text or seeing them in public or at a game or whatever it is, they're so into trying to make change and so into trying to understand what, you know, we as Black men and women, what our lives are like here in America. And I think over the last year or so was really eye-opening for them. And for me, coming from Memphis, you know, Memphis, Tennessee feels like it's predominantly, you know, Black people there. And even though it's, the numbers will say different, but there's a lot more Black people there than there is in Utah. And, me coming to Utah was, for me, is just educating, you know, just trying to have opportunities to explain to them, you know, exactly what our lives are like and what it's been like for us growing up here, and what Kyle Korver is doing is necessary. It's, you know, it's a responsibility that not only we have, but him as a white American and every other white American has to try to make change, because for so long, I think it's been put on our shoulders as Black men and women to get ourselves out of this situation. And I think that with their help is the only way we can, you know, see change. And just very proud of the men and women and Kyle Korver and all the guys in our league who have really stepped up and stepped out, and whether however uncomfortable it may be, have done the right thing and supporting something that's truly going to matter and something that they can truly, you know, help create change.
And that's great. And Harrison, a similar question to you. You know, I just interviewed Matt Barnes also from a podcast, The Rematch, and he talked about the way that Sacramento as a whole, the team really, you know, came around after Stephon Clark was murdered and supported his efforts. And, you know, he organized the march and how the organization stepped up. How important is it for the organization as a whole, and not just Sacramento Kings, but every NBA organization that is in a city where something like this happens, for them to step up and to speak out against it and to also to use their position and their platform to actually create change, because they have a lot of power.
No, I think it's, you know, very important. I remember playing here on the opposing team, you know, shortly after Stephon Clark was murdered, and, you know, just seeing the community not only mourn, but just really just be enraged and passionate about change and not wanting to see another one of their own die in that way. And, you know, for organizations to be able to, one, have that connection with the community, you know, every organization is different. You know, the Kings do a great job of actually tapping in with the community, but two, getting out there, you know, being on those front lines of people, being in the community, supporting, not just, you know, with statements or with financial donations, but, you know, actually going out there and doing the work. I think that's really important because of the place that sports occupies in our communities, but also just the awareness and attention that we can bring.
Definitely agree. Sydney, same question to you. And the WNBA has been doing such an amazing job as a whole. Whenever I'm speaking with young people, with high school and colleges, and they ask about, you know, how they should go about activism, I always use the WNBA as an example, just because of the way that you all do everything together. And I want to talk about that power of doing it together as one voice and everybody unified. How important is that for, you know, speaking in terms of younger generations, younger athletes, to understand that concept of moving together as one unit and as a whole?
I think that, you know, it goes a long way when you see the rival teammate or rival teams or people that you compete against on a daily basis are now wanting to come together and make sure that we're working toward a common goal, like I spoke about before. Like, it won't always be one person's idea who is the one that's used, but we're willing to come together and unite because we realize, okay, well, you know, maybe my idea isn't gonna be the one that's used, but is it gonna bring attention to, say her name, is it gonna bring attention to Breonna Taylor's case, to their foundation, to whoever needs to be made aware of this? Like, that's the most important thing to us. And for our council, for the Social Justice Council, like, we made it our mission this last season to make sure that we were educating each other and our fans, and that we were amplifying our messages, like, through social media, through our advisors, and that we were mobilizing people to act, you know, our fans, making sure that they were getting engaged, making sure that we were having things going on throughout the season. Like, every game we would have, okay, if we scored however many points, the team is going to donate $100 per point or something like that. Every three-pointer made, every assist. We made sure that we had things going so that these grassroots programs were going to get money throughout the season, because it's one thing, like Harrison said, to give money, to give support. But when you have organizations who've been doing this work for a long time, like, they need funding to keep doing that. And they're going to need funding to keep doing it well past when our season ends. So it was critical to us to make sure that we were being engaged and working together to make sure we were doing something for the common good and not worrying about who was going to get the attention, because that's not what's important.
I think that's great. Mike, I want to ask you, do you feel that you still have that element kind of lingering of people that want athletes to kind of stay in their lane, to still have that shut up and dribble type of thing? Or is that kind of going away a little bit? Because it's hard to tell sometimes. What is your thought on that?
Well, you know, I think it's still there. It's still kind of like this racism in general. You know, it was really out in the open however many years ago, and nowadays it's, you know, you see it in bits and pieces, and it tries to be suppressed, but it's still there, and there's still people that are openly racist, but, you know, hide in the shadows. I feel it's the same situation with us as athletes. I think a lot of people don't want to hear us speak on it. They don't want to hear us speak on politics. They don't want us to you know, be out here being that voice. They'd rather just us be entertainment, and that is still there, whether people are saying it or not. We feel it every now and then. You'll see it, you know, a couple people here and there make a statement about, like, something like that towards us as athletes, but it you know, I don't think that's going to go away out of the minds of people so soon. That's something that is still engraved in a lot of people. So it's going to take a lot of time for things to change. But as athletes, we do have a responsibility to you know, voice our opinion, our thoughts, and be role models for our younger generation, our kids, to hope that they're the ones that can take the baton and get this thing to the finish line.
You know, I interviewed NBA Commissioner Adam Silver for my book, We Matter, Athletes and Activism. And I asked him if about the atmosphere that he pretty much created, the safe space where, you know, as athletes, you don't really feel that there are going to be repercussions if you do speak out. Now, that's not the same in every league, and we don't have to even name the leagues, but, you know, every league doesn't have that same level of flexibility and that comfortability. And Harrison, I wanted you to speak to it a little bit, you know, because there's still, even with that, there's that little bit of notion sometimes where, you know, from the past, where an athlete like Craig Hodges or Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, you know, found himself banished from the league after they stood out. But this is a different time now. And I feel that there is really a safe space where athletes can really voice their opinion. And Adam Silver, I was happy that he said that and made that point clear in my book. How would you describe the atmosphere of the NBA? And is it really a safe space?
You know, I think the NBA does a great job of not only allowing players to say what they feel and how they feel, but not penalizing people for that opinion. But also, you know, it's credit to the players, because even if there is a safe space, even if there is opportunity to speak, each player has to carry what they say well beyond the court. You know, they still have to go into their communities, whether it's the ones that they play in or the ones they come from, and they have to stand on these stances or these, you know, beliefs that they have about what's going on. So, you know, I definitely think that, you know, the NBA provides a great opportunity to be able to use the platform and to speak, but as well as, you know, the players in the NBA and the WNBA for having the courage to speak on these things and follow through with that.
I think that's great. I definitely agree. And Sydney, I want to ask you, you know, where do we move from having conversations to really be able to impact change in the system? And I love the way that, I mean, I can't stop speaking about the WNBA and how you all do everything and what everyone did in Georgia. I mean, y'all actually, you know, flipped Georgia blue. And honestly, nobody thought that could have even possibly happened. And you all did. And it's important to really to point out that, you know, when Warnock first got into the race, he was polling at 9% before y'all got involved. 9%. You know, I'm not saying that it wouldn't have gotten better, but at that point, you know, it was at 9%, and then y'all got involved. Talk about how you all did that as well, and how you all used your voices collectively and impacted an election, and, you know, combined with Stacey Abrams and the people, mm-hmm. the boots on the ground and everything like that, and just how you all did everything.
Man, Etan, I'm gonna just say, listen to Black women, we be knowing. Now,
right.
Stacey Abrams, like, I'm glad that you asked this, because she could have just given up, gone about her business, like, okay, I didn't win this governor race in, what, 2018? Like, y'all don't want to listen, I'm out. But if you remember, like, Black Twitter, social media was like, Stacey spun the block, she came back around, she started those campaigns that were wanting to educate people and get people more engaged in voting. And what she did, along with, you know, the other Black women that were with her that don't get as much attention, but they are the ones who started all of that.
Harrison, we just wrapped up a big election here in the US that saw a record turnout. I know your nickname around the league is the Senator, and you work closely with When We All Vote to make sure folks get out and get engaged and vote, you know, in the civic process. How do we sustain the momentum going forward, particularly in local elections?
I think you see that with what happened in Georgia. You know, we talk a lot about doing the work. We talk a lot about change. And a lot of that boils down to legislation. How do we get not only the people who represent us, but the laws to reflect and protect our communities. So that is the constant battle and education process of, you know, just continuing to encourage people to stay involved, to vote, not only once every 4 years, not every 2 years, but in your local elections, and really put the people in office who are going to represent you all the time.
That's good. That's good. Mike, we've seen more and more players, coaches, and teams get engaged in direct advocacy. The NBA family recently launched the National Basketball Social Justice Coalition to advance racial equality through policy change at the state, local and federal levels. What should the NBA and WNBA and the teams do to help players translate their passions to real change?
Well, I think, you know, what the NBA and WNBA will do and have, you know, quite frankly, have been doing is giving us opportunities and every resource that we can to get whatever we want to get out, whatever we're trying to achieve, whatever passion we may have, whether, like Harrison said, whether it's through legislation or education or, you know, police reform, whatever your thing may be. I think the league and WNBA have given us the tools and are starting to give us the tools to get things done from our end. And as players, and Donovan Mitchell is one of my teammates, and he's part of that, you know, coalition that you just previously talked about, and just being able to speak with him and get his mind, you know, get what's going on in his mind, and what, you know, after they have meetings, and, you know, just the work he's been able to do over, you know, the last year or two has been phenomenal. And that has been with the help of the league and what they've been able to provide. So just, I'm sure that it's going to continue to double down and see that the players have everything they need in order to try to achieve their goals.
Let me ask a follow-up with that with you, Mike. You know, talking about George Floyd, the murder of George Floyd, and, you know, how that was a moment that allowed the world to see what African-Americans and people of color experience all too often. You know, for Black people all across the country, it was a traumatic and horrifying experience to be able to see it. But it wasn't all that surprising. You know, we've seen this happen many times before. How are you using your platform in particular to help put an end to this cycle of senseless police violence?
Well, you know, obviously since George Floyd and last summer, I think we all, you know, felt a certain way. We felt angry. We felt tired, you know, just really motivated to see change through. And for me, you know, a lot of it has been through education. Like, for instance, right now I executively produced a film called Two Distant Strangers. The director, Trayvon Free, reached out, you know, a few months ago about the idea of pushing out a film that highlights, you know, the millions of situations that Black men and women find themselves in with law enforcement that end up in violence and unjustly, you know. And for me, it's just, you know, being a part of a film like that helps us as Black people kind of control our narrative a little bit and push out what we want to push out and give you an idea from our lens exactly what kind of situations we find ourselves in and how can we change that. And that film has been a huge part of my last few months and trying to educate people on, you know, how and why these things are happening and what can we do to change them. And like I said, we're going to need everybody's help to do that. Not just the Black community. We're going to need our, you know, our white friends, our, you know, the legislative, the politicians, everybody's got to be involved. And I'm hoping that films like what I've been able to be a part of and speaking to different groups and being on Zoom calls and just being able to continue to raise awareness, but educate folks on the importance of what we're going through right now and how we can each individually do something and have a part that can play a big role in our success in changing it.
Well, listen, I got to say much respect to all of y'all for the work that y'all are doing. The way that you're using your platforms, but then also the actual work that you're doing beyond, you know, speaking about it. You know, I think that we're kind of past the phase of awareness. You know, I think everybody kind of knows there's an issue now. And now it's like, where do we go from here? How do we bring about change? And the work that all of y'all are doing is just really important. And I can't, you know, praise you enough for it. So I want to thank everyone for joining us for this important discussion. Do not let this conversation end now or be limited to Black History Month. To learn more about the NBA and WNBA's ongoing work on these issues, visit nba.com/BHM today. And with that, I say thank you, and thank you for listening.